Hi gang, this is Matt Sumpstein, and I developed the Aloha Clinic training videos, and have for about the past 6 years. This year I'm adding a category called helmet contact. It's been a big point of emphasis the last couple of years, and the video is designed to add some philosophy to allow us to determine what should be called and what should not be called. College football has terminology like targeting and launching. High school football has terminology like spearing and illegal helmet contact. Many of these terms are interchangeable and will be used that way throughout the video. As always, if you have any questions, feel free to give me a call. You know I love to talk about football. Anyway, I hope it helps, and have a great season. Guys, this is the new helmet contact video that I've developed to hopefully add some philosophy, develop some discussion. I've introduced a new terminology called a compressed target. The compressed target terminology refers to when a running back or a ball carrier gets into a low position where there's only one area where the defender has to approach to make the tackle, and that would include some helmet contact that otherwise would be legal. It does not excuse illegal helmet contact in any way, a very serious penalty and injury possibility. It does not excuse the butt blocking, does not excuse spearing, or intentionally using the helmet to punish a player. The only thing the compressed target terminology refers to is incidental contact in the way of making a tackle that includes the helmet that is otherwise unavoidable and does not fall into a penalty category. Defer to your association. This is not a National Federation term. It's not an NCAA term. It's just something I use to help explain some of the situations that occur on this video. Thank you. This first section, we're going to talk about a compressed target. And what I mean by that is the ball carrier. If the ball carrier catches the ball or runs with the ball and presents a compressed target, it makes it much more difficult for the defender to avoid helmet contact. Here we see an upright posture. If he were to target the helmet here, it's a foul. Here we see a compressed target. He has lowered his helmet. Therefore, he's creating a very small target for the defender. So the question becomes on this kind of play is, who do you throw the flag on? The running back for dipping his head or the defender for getting low trying to make a tackle? Slow motion again. You can see the defender set. The running back moves to him. The defender tries to get low. Running back dips. If you're going to throw it, who do you throw it on? This kind of situation, I like the no call. Play number two is a running play. It goes off to the left side. Again, we're talking about the runner or ball carrier or receiver compressing their target. This looks like a case of the defender trying to go low shoulder and the running back creates a helmet contact by his head dip. And you can see this runner, he's fighting for yardage. He sees the guy coming in. When we go back to this sideline view, you can see, and I'll stop it when he gets into an upright position just before the hit, which is right here. If he's hit here in the helmet, and he's upright, then we've got a foul. But he sees that defender coming, and he crouches down, compressing his target, leaving the defender no viable choice as to where to hit, and their helmets hit. This is another situation where I like the no call. If you don't know or you're in question, yeah, philosophy says throw it. But it's something to think about. Play number three. This is going to be a quarterback scramble. He does get outside the tackle. Starts to look like a runner. Crosses the line of scrimmage. So there is no passer considerations any longer involved in this. You can see that the helmet's hit. There is a flag thrown. It's a blue flag. There's some awareness charity going on this game. But the contact is after the quarterback starts to crouch. In fact, he fumbles the ball before the contact. The defender does not know that, though. But you can see the quarterback's up right here. If he's targeted high here, then you may have a foul. But the quarterback is on his way down. The defender is crouching to make a low hit on the quarterback, and at the last second, the quarterback is driven down, and then the helmet's hit. It's really hard to lay this on the defender. If you throw it, if you don't know, philosophy says we're going to support the call, or whomever your association is probably will. I look at this play and I just think it is a great discussion play. Play number 4, it's a kick return near the sideline. You can see number 20, the ball carrier. He gets near the sideline, gets a little bit out of balance, and starts to crouch and go down. This was really a secondary hit. The defender hit the player on the shoulder. It made the head whiplash in toward the defender, and then the defender followed through on the hit, sliding up and then pushing the helmet back. This was a compressed target. It wasn't initially at the head, and the defender really had nothing else to hit. Play number 5 is a long pass complete with a peel back block. And peel back blocks you've got to be very careful of and aware of. I've got them highlighted here. Back judge, you have got to pick up this block. Bam, you can see the helmet's hit. The pursuing possible tackler goes down. And this play I've changed my mind on a few times, but I'm going now with illegal helmet contact. And I did say back judge earlier, but headlinesman, you've got to pick this up. You've got that block right next to the runner. That's a threat position for you, and you've got a clean view of it. But because the blocker's got an open field, a clean view, an open approach angle, he is responsible to keep his helmet off of the pursuer's helmet, even if he's crouched. So take a top-down block on this play, and we keep it legal. This is one of those plays where we haven't really had a lot of dialogue about it, and now we've got an opportunity. So hopefully it'll help you. Now let's talk about launching. Now, just because you launch doesn't mean you've created a foul. It just means you're suspect for it. We've got to keep an eye on you. So you watch this at full speed. Lots of guys say, wow, targeting, that's a foul. Well, what we have to train ourselves to do, back judges and wing guys in a five-man mechanic, side judge, field judge in a seven, is to watch the defender coming in, shoulder below the pads, right in the gut. This is a legal play, although he did create an act of launching. Play number 2, again, it's just going to be a one-time shot. We take a look at it real quick. Is this launching? Yeah, he launches right into him, but he launches into his chest. This is a legal contact. The defenders are now making the adjustments to the point of emphasis on the rule for hitting at the shoulders, neck, and head area. It's a great defensive play. Play number 3. Watch it again. Let's see if we've got targeting here. Definitely goes at him, kind of launches, a little bit midsection, but this is not a foul. This was called illegal helmet contact on the field. Somebody has to pull him off. That adjustment was made in technique by the coaching staff and the player, and that's a legal hit. Very good. Play number 4. And the last one of the launching legals. That was definitely a launch. He definitely left his feet with a forward momentum, but he timed his target position correctly, and this is not a foul. Like the last example, it's just a good example of a midsection shoulder hit. Completely legal. These next two plays are spearing fouls. They don't have anything to do with launching or really even live ball play. This first one is a pass out to the flat. The third guy in is the one that we want to watch. There's one, there's two. Third guy dives in like a submarine, lowers the top of his helmet. What we're doing here is we're trying to protect the tackler from a spinal injury. This is an illegal hit and a good call, and called that way on the field. Play number 2, this is a botched snap. And had the defender not led with his helmet and created a helmet contact, I don't think we have a foul here for late hit or anything else. But the punter did recover the ball. There's a very brief period of time between when he does and when the contact happens. But the defender is obligated to avoid that helmet contact when you've got a defenseless player laying there on the ground. So that helmet contact, even though the timing was not generally considered a personal foul. Because of the location of the hit, we've got a foul. Alright, let's move into launch with contact. So I've got three examples. Two of them are from my games. This first one is from a high school game. Pass over the middle. The contact dislodges the football, which is then intercepted. There's no flag thrown, but there definitely was a launching act. The initial contact was at the shoulders, neck, and helmet area, and the helmets do hit. So this should have been a foul. You can see that the upright receiver's there. We've got a launching act, and when we get right into the end zone view, you can see the defender launching up. Helmets hit here. This should have been a foul. You can see the upright position of the receiver, so that's one we need to call. Play number two. This was from one of my games. The receiver crosses the middle, very quick slant pass, and then you've got contact. Doesn't look horrible. Well, this isn't a foul that you want to throw somebody out on, but it is a launching foul, and you can see it from this angle. Elbow, shoulder, right to the neck, head area, upright receiver. Those are the kind of hits we're looking to eliminate from the game. I don't know that we'll ever get them all out, but if you hit that with the penalty, then we're on our way to doing it. Play number three. Also one of my games. A little unusual. Watch the slot guy coming over the middle. And the part that makes this a little bit weird is that the receiver doesn't go down. He goes down to one knee, and then the defender gets hurt. But you can see a definite launching act, definitely high, and the receiver is upright. So even though the contact is what I would consider slight, the act itself is a dangerous one, and this one should be called. You can see the defender come in, launching act. He does hit the receiver at the shoulder neck area, possibly the head, but this is one that we can call. Last three plays, these are potentially disqualifying hits, and we're going to take a real close look at them and discuss what makes them that way. We've got a punt play, and then the covering team that's coming down, you can see the highlighted player there in the upright rectangle, he is being targeted by that blocker. And it doesn't look so bad there, but what makes this a potentially disqualifying foul is the upright position of the potential tackler and the upright helmet-to-chin position of the block. That is a very, very dangerous play, and it needs to be called a foul and potentially a disqualification. Play number two. I just don't like this play because of what the defender does. It's clearly out of bounds. The helmet-to-helmet contact is pretty clear. 1, 2, 3, 4 steps out of bounds. Helmet-to-helmet contact. To me, there's no place in football for this. Late hit, yes. But if you go in helmet-to-helmet, that's potentially a disqualification foul. So that's something worth talking about. Play number three. This is the last one on this video, and it's an interaction between that number two receiver at the top and the safety that was highlighted in the middle. He's got nothing whatsoever to do with the play, and he goes in there and targets an upright player who's defenseless, hits him with the helmet right in the chin. There's a big helmet pop on the field. There was a roughing the passer called, but to me, that's not the foul that we needed to get as a priority. The priority foul was the interaction between this slot receiver and the cornerback slash safety. So take another look. Discuss it with your association, but I sure would have liked to see a DQ on this play.